Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Castle for Rent by John DeChancie, narrated by Kyle Burrow. The splendor falls on castle walls and snowy summits old in story. The long light shakes across the lakes, and the wild cataract leaps in glory. Blow, bugle, blow! Set the wild echoes flying. Blow, bugle. Answer, echoes. Dying, dying, dying. Tennyson. Prologue. Cellar, near the donjon. In a niche, in a crypt, deep within a great castle, a section of wall vanished and revealed a high-raftered, pelt-hung room which evoked the interior of a Viking hall, but not quite. Two creatures stood in the room, facing each other. They were not human, but approximated human form. Their faces were huge and wrinkled, their eyes narrow slits over a blunt snout split by a mouth not unlike a hippopotamus's, save that the teeth were numerous and sharp. They had thick, squat bodies, exorbitantly muscled with leathery blue skin. They wore pieces of shiny green armor that could have been plastic or fiberglass or some composite material, or perhaps sections of the carapace of a giant insect. Both creatures wore swords and daggers in ornate scabbards. The behavior and mannerisms of both creatures could generally be described as an exaggeration, perhaps even a parody, of behavior patterns peculiar to a certain type of over-aggressive male human. The sudden materialization of the opening had interrupted a conversation, rather, a confrontation involving bared teeth, threatening postures, and much angry grunting and gesticulating. The creature who faced the opening stopped in mid-gesture, his six-fingered hand raised to strike the other creature. A puzzled expression formed on his inhuman countenance. The other creature had backed off, hand darting to the curving grip of a pistol in a hip holster. Slowly, the first creature lowered his arm, then grunted and motioned toward the opening which lay at his adversary's back. The other grunted threateningly in reply, warily maintaining his orientation and taking another step back. He wasn't taking any chances. The first grunted again, pointing emphatically toward the suddenly created doorway. The second creature couldn't resist casting a glance to the rear. He did an almost comic double take and whirled around to face the opening. Their argument temporarily forgotten, the two approached the anomaly. The second creature drew his weapon, a strange thing with a short barrel and a large underhanging clip. Cautiously, they peered out. There was nothing immediately outside the opening, but the bare stone walls of a corridor running to darkness at either hand. The gun-bearing creature stuck his head out and looked one way, then the other. He snorted. Then he said,
"Secret passage. Escape tunnel."
The other grunted something in reply. The first holstered his weapon and stepped out into the corridor.
"Runs directly to Proconsul's quarters. Leads to outside. Convenient,"
said the first creature as it came through the doorway.
"But where did Wall go?"
He examined the dark stone of the corridor, still looking puzzled.
"Wonder where stone comes from. Strange stuff."
He thumped a blue fist against it. The gun-toting creature sniffed the air, snout wriggling.
"Something not right here."
The other glanced about warily.
"Strange. Very strange."
They wandered about, sniffing high and low, probing cracks and crannies with fat, blunt fingers.
"Sorcerer's work,"
the unarmed creature pronounced, peering at multicolored glittering motes that lay deep within the stone.
You think? What else? I saw wall disappear. You are drunk. If I want excrement from you, I will squeeze it out of your head. And I will make you eat it, along with your words, dung breath.
The two squared off and snarled at each other for a spell. Gradually, the tension lessened as they were again distracted by the strange apparition.
Sorcerer's work, I tell you. Nonsense. Escape tunnel. Nothing more. Look at seam here, between stone and wood. Blurry!
The creature put his hand up against the juncture and observed that the hand became indistinct, then withdrew it as if from something hot.
Look!
Far down the corridor, a mote of light danced in the darkness. Soon, footsteps approached. The two creatures went into defensive stances. Hi there! Came a voice from down the hall. A human approached. A short bearded man in jeans and a t-shirt. He stopped a short distance away. He held an odd lantern. It was a long wooden handle with a huge glowing jewel affixed to the end. The jewel glowed an eerie blue-white. Hi, Mort Kaufman's the name. Have you two just wandered into the castle? The one with the gun slowly straightened.
What sort of creature are you?
He barked.
And what are you doing in Stronghold of Proconsul?
The what of who? Kaufman laughed. You got it wrong. I should be asking what you're doing here. But, of course, I know perfectly well what you're doing. You were just minding your own business when all of a sudden, a wall in your... He stepped forward and peeked into the opening. Living room? Yeah, a wall in your living room suddenly went poof, and a doorway pops out of nowhere, and you go through, and you wind up here, and you're wondering, what's it all about, right? The creature thrust the pistol toward him.
I ask you question. Speak, or I will drill hole in your hairy head.
Kaufman backed off. Hey, now look, I don't want any trouble with you guys. Just being friendly is all. I'm just trying to help out. You know, you really shouldn't... The unarmed creature rushed him. The jewel torch clattered to the floor and Kaufman went flying. The corridor wall interrupted his flight with a sickening thud. The creature then picked him up like a limp rag and began to pummel him mercilessly. The other creature went for the torch, scooped the thing up, and examined it. At length, he looked over his shoulder and growled,
Don't kill it. Proconsul will want to interrogate.
Kaufman lay still on the floor, one arm at an anatomically improbable angle.
Two-legged hairy creature that talks. Fantastic. Where did it come from? From this place, wherever. Look, it has red blood. I can see that, fool. Can you also see, idiot, that there is something more to this?
The other regarded the torch again.
Perhaps so.
It ran a sausage-like finger over the handle. The unarmed creature pointed at Kaufman.
Come, we must report this. Bring creature.
When the other gave no response,
That is my order.
The other glared back.
I urinate on your orders. You have no authority over me. I have Proconsul's authority. I am his chief of staff. As captain of Stronghold Guard, you are technically under my command. Obey. Slime-eating schemer! You backstabbed your way to power.
The other smiled toothily.
I could have you shot.
His hand was a blur as it slipped behind his breastplate, Bringing forth a small pistol, he trained it on the captain.
I could shoot you right now. You are a coward as well.
The chief of staff's smile faded. Slowly, he put the pistol back into its hiding place. He brought back his hand to his side.
Now make your move.
It was quiet. Both creatures remained motionless for several minutes. The captain of the guard carefully unbent and relaxed.
This is foolish. I will fetch prisoner.
The chief of staff picked up the torch. Looking it over, he walked toward the opening. Just as he reached it, he caught sight of what the captain was about to do. The captain's pistol smoked and sputtered. A brief flame coughed from the end of the barrel. That was all. Dumbfounded, the captain stood looking at the useless weapon in his hand, briefly, until a dagger suddenly grew in his throat. He dropped the pistol, gurgled, and fell dead. Bright purple blood issued from the wound. The chief of staff retrieved the knife and picked up the gun. He looked at one, then the other.
Strange.
Throwing down the gun, he grabbed the human by the hair and dragged him back through the portal. Six, approximately, months, for lack of a better word, later. Over the plains of Baranth. He pushed the stick forward. The nose of the jet fighter dipped, allowing him to view the entirety of Castle Perilous atop its high promontory. It was as it always had been, a vast, dark edifice of eye-defying complexity, a jumble of towers, turrets, bulwarks, and other fortifications, all ringed by concentric curtain walls. The central keep soared into the clouds. The castle sat like a magistrate high on his bench, delivering judgments to the plains below and the snow-capped mountains beyond. The castle belonged to him, as it had to his father, his father's father, his father's father's, etc., and all his forebears unto many generations. It was his home, one of them at least, his freehold, and his fortress. It was the biggest white elephant in the world, in several worlds, in fact, but he loved the place. He sent the plane into a wide banking circle around the castle and spent a good quarter hour inspecting it. As old as it was, the castle looked as though it had been built yesterday. No weathering discolored its stone, no mortar crumbled from its joints and cornices. It looked spanking new. In fact, it had been magically reconstructed a little less than a year before. Without warning, the jet's single engine died with a whistling whine, and the lights on the instrument panel blinked, then went out. "Infernal machine," he said irritably, shaking his head. He worked his fingers in complex patterns and muttered an incantation. The engine coughed once, roared to life, but faded seconds later. He worked his fingers again, chanting monotonously. No use. The engine was dead. The jet dropped like a stone. He could have effected a levitation spell to keep it up, but that was hardly fun. Sighing, he waved his hand. The jet disappeared and was instantly replaced by a helicopter. He took the control bars, checked his counter-rotation, and put the ship into a steep dive. He leveled off near the ground and hovered. The earth was blackened as if by a great fire. The copter bore down. Charred skeletons lay among the dust of the plain, the remains of the last army that had laid siege to Castle Perilous. The siege had been long and bitter, and the castle had almost fallen. But the besiegers had met a horrible end. The helicopter's motor sputtered and choked. Damn! He was dangerously close to the ground. He worked his fingers fast. The aircraft that appeared around him was an eclectic meld of curving silver metal and clear, tear-shaped bubbles. It hummed and crackled. He looked over the controls. He had flown one of these only twice in his life, then gingerly put the tips of his fingers on the control panel. The craft shot toward the virginal blue sky with astonishing speed. He leveled off at 10,000 feet, the castle still bulking hugely below him. "Now to do what I came up here for," he said. There was a computer terminal, of sorts, to his right. He studied it briefly, then punched in some data. A small screen next to the terminal lit up. He was busy for several minutes. Then he looked up and searched the skies. By the end of an hour, his neck hurt horribly and his eyes burned from reading instruments. It was hard work. The craft's engines had failed regularly every 10 minutes or so and had to be bolstered by complex levitation spells. The last of these was now fading rapidly.
"There you are."
A fuzzy gray splotch floated against the bright sky. It looked like a defect in a camera lens, nebulous, out of focus. He headed the craft for it. Worried that the engine might fail just at the wrong moment, he transformed the craft back to a jet fighter just before entry. The sky didn't change color by much. It turned perhaps a shade lighter. Below sprawled an immense city cut by two rivers and outlined by a harbor. A long, thin finger of land, bristling with skyscrapers, ran between the rivers.
"I should have known. All roads lead to New York."
Smiling, he banked and turned toward Manhattan. It had been a long time. Presently, the radio sputtered and blurped.
"Kennedy Air Traffic Control to Unidentified Military Aircraft, calling Unidentified Military Aircraft. You are intruding in controlled airspace. Come in."
"Yes?"
"Unidentified aircraft, descend to 1,500 feet immediately. You are in a controlled air corridor. Acknowledge, please."
"In a moment."
"Negative, negative. You must—"
He snapped the radio off. This would never do. He suddenly realized how unprepared he was. Awkward, really. The plane around him began to fade. Of course, he had forgotten how inhospitable this world was to magic. Things were damned difficult here as far as the arts were concerned. It was ironic. The jet didn't work very well back home because the universe of the castle was not amenable to mechanical contrivances, even conjured ones. Here, the jet worked fine, but its very existence was tenuous at best, precisely because it was entirely a magical construct. He was getting the worst of both worlds. That left him in somewhat of a pickle, one he should have smelled far off. A simple shield spell protected him from most of the air blast when the jet finally faded out of existence, but even that began to wear off quickly. He stretched out his arms and legs and went into free-fall posture. Plummeting toward the cold gray expanse of the East River, he decided that he would have to think of something very fast. Elsewhere.
"I've gotten to like the castle," Linda Barclay said as she munched a kosher dill. "But I still have really serious bouts of homesickness."
Sitting with his back against the tree, under which he and Linda were enjoying a picnic lunch, Gene Ferraro bit into a cheese-laden cracker.
"That's normal. I don't get so much homesick as bored with life here. I mean, in the castle. I'd like to get out into some of the more exciting worlds. Explore a little, you know?"
"You're big for adventure. I'm not. I'm basically a homebody."
"And one of the most powerful sorceresses around."
"Only in the castle and in some of the magic is the rule worlds. That's what I like about my life here, as opposed to back in the normal world. Magic is fun."
"Sure is."
"Normal world?
No such thing. Our world is just one of many, and a pretty dreary one at that."
"It's so nice here."
Linda looked out across the meadow. Bright sunlight brought out the delirious green of the grass,
and a soft breeze stirred the budding tree above. It was fine, first warm day of spring weather.
Yeah, but I'd still like to do some exploring.
Jean looked over his shoulder. Take that big house over there. Linda looked at the top of the huge dome that barely showed above the crest of the hill to the right. Did you ever go over and take a look at it?
No, she said. It's a monster. It obviously belongs to someone, as does this whole estate. But the place is deserted.
I guess that's why everyone in the castle comes here to picnic.
It's nice and there's no one to bother you.
A bird chirped in a nearby tree. Woolly clouds plopped sheep-like across a blue-violet sky. Jean sighed and stretched out, hands laced together at the back of his head. A sword in its leather scabbard lay in the grass at his left side. Linda said,
"The way I hear, some of the castle's worlds are pretty depopulated due to wars, plagues, and other nasty things."
Jean looked off into the sky.
The castle's worlds. Say it that way, and it sounds like none of these places would exist if the castle didn't.
I wonder.
I never heard that. Kind of weird to think that our whole Earth existed just because Castle Perilous created a time warp, or whatever you call it.
Space-time warp. That's a scientific way of putting it. But Castle Perilous and everything about it has to do with magic, not science.
Maybe the magic is just like science, only with different laws.
Jean shrugged. Hard to say. He yawned. An insect buzzed about his head. He ignored it. Linda stretched out one leg and adjusted her tights, then recrossed her legs. She echoed Jean's yawn.
Stop that. It's catching.
Jean feigned a loud, ripping snore. Linda chuckled.
Maybe I should Z out, too. It was cold in the castle last night. I shivered all night long.
Yeah, it does get cold sometimes, Jean murmured, eyes closed.
Linda looked off down the slope of the meadow.
Jean?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen a world with blue-skinned, muscle-bound creatures that wear green armor?
Jean's right eye popped open.
Huh?
Look.
There were three of them, trooping in step up the hill. They were armed with swords and pistols, and all three wore backpacks.
Linda said, "Something tells me these guys don't live here."
"Right. They're definitely prospecting, checking the place out."
"Their armor's pretty."
"Yeah. Linda, does your magic work here?"
"I've never tried. I whipped the food up back in the castle."
She looked off, her brow furrowed.
"I think so."
She made a motion with her hand.
"Yeah, it works a little."
"Good. Then maybe those guns they're toting won't work."
Jean's right hand went to the hilt of his sword.
"Here they come, straight for us. Get ready to move fast."
At the last minute, the three strange creatures changed course to the left and marched by, their big webbed feet crushing the overgrown grass in purposeful steps. One of them regarded Jean and Linda coldly. The others looked straight ahead. When they disappeared over the rise, Jean let go of his sword.
"I wonder what that was all about."
Linda shrugged. Jean snapped his fingers.
"Wait a minute. I thought something was familiar about them. Don Kelly was telling me about how people have been seeing strange-looking new aliens around the castle. Blue-skinned, short, chunky guys. Lots of them. Usually going around in threes. They don't mix. Keep to themselves. In fact, they're supposed to be kind of belligerent if pressed. Those must be the ones."
"I wonder what their world is like."
Jean shook his head. "Each one of those guys must be 275, maybe 300 pounds, at least. They look like good fighters. Too good."
"Do you think they're trouble?"
Jean shrugged.
"No real reason to think they would be. They seem to mind their own business."
He mulled it over. "Trouble is, they look like they have business." Linda nodded.
"Serious business."
They were silent for a while.
"Have we been here a year yet?" Linda asked. Who's keeping track of time?
Yeah, I guess.
Linda let out a long breath. It seems shorter. Sometimes I still think this is all a dream.
I know what you mean.
A year ago, I'm in Los Angeles, leading a normal life. I have a dull job, but I live near the beach in Santa Monica. It's okay, I guess, but I get depressed sometimes, a lot of the time, and I take a lot of pills. Then, one day, when I'm feeling especially down, I open my closet and find that someone's torn out the back wall. I walk through and find this place that looks like the inside of a castle.
Jean broke in. And the opening closes behind you and you can't find a way back to your closet. And then you find there are all kinds of people in this castle. Some good, some bad, some strange, some not. And the place is absolutely crazy, with doorways that lead to a million different worlds and universes.
Crazy isn't the word. Insane, bonkers, stark raving Looney Tunes.
Never a dull moment.
And there's even a king in this castle, by the name of Incarnadine.
Jean sighed. Yeah, sounds familiar. Except I came in by way of an odd doorway in a parking garage in downtown Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, of all places.
Wanna go back?
Huh? To our world? The good old USA where I was born, like the song says?
Well, I meant the castle, but answer the question any way you want to.
I don't know. The only thing that worries me is my parents. They must have given up hope by now.
And mine.
Sure wish there was a way to get a message back.
Just a message?
Jean nodded. I like Castle Perilous. It's the ultimate trip, to use an expression out of the 60s.
Let's trip back to the castle. I want to take a nap.
At once, m'lady.
Jean got to his feet and strapped on his sword.
Linda packed the wicker basket while Jean folded up the square of white linen they had used for a ground cloth. Then, they both headed up the hill. The portal leading back to the castle stood among some trees just over the rise.
I'm glad Snowclaw finally found a way back to his world, Jean said. Poor baby. He was practically dying from the heat.
Yeah, he was in pretty bad shape. His fur was coming off in hunks.
I miss him.
So do I.
35th and Madison. When Alice Sussman heard the name of the author who was out at the front desk, she had to run to the files. Sure enough, the Spade Books backlist did show 5 titles published under the name of C. Wainwright Smithton. The titles hadn't been reprinted in years, decades. She went to her Who's Who shelf and consulted several reference books. C. Wainwright Smithton was mentioned once or twice, but information was sketchy. He was British, but emigrated here, wrote for the pulps in the 30s and 40s, and published a few science fiction novels over the next 2 decades. His work attracted much critical attention. One book referred to him as an elusive genius. As senior editor of Science Fiction and Fantasy, it was Alice's duty to show hospitality to important writers who dropped in to visit, even if no one had ever heard of them.
"Very nice to meet you, Mr. Smithton,"
Alice said as she took the hand of the handsome, white-haired gentleman in the checkered overcoat.
"You haven't been in to see us in quite some time."
"Oh, 30 years, I should say," Smithton said with a laugh. "I had a little trouble tracking down Spade Books until I learned it had been bought out by the Bishop Publishing Galaxy."
"Spade Books still exists, Mr. Smithton, and it's doing fine. In fact, it's one of our strongest fiction lines. Won't you please come back to my office?"
Alice got him settled down with a cup of coffee on the couch in her office. She took the chair.
"What can we do for you, Mr. Smithton?"
"Oh, you can give me a book contract with an advance in 6 figures and 100% of subsidiary rights," he grinned.
She grinned back.
"We'd love to see a proposal from you, Mr. Smithton. I'm sure you still have many fans out there who'd buy a book with your name on it. After all, you're one of the veteran writers in the field.
I'd be surprised if any of my old fans were still alive. I haven't had anything in print for years and years.
Yes, I know. We put out reissues of backlist titles every month. Your name has come up several times during our weekly editorial meetings. I'm sorry to say we haven't actually done anything about it yet, but...
Quite all right, Miss Sussman. You couldn't have, anyway. The rights have long since reverted to me, and I was out of contact for so long. I'm not complaining. I've been out of the country for years. I just recently came back to New York to look into some financial affairs of mine. Unfortunately, things haven't worked out the way I expected, and frankly, to use the modern idiom, I'm having cash flow problems.
Alice sat back and crossed her legs. I see. Well, we'd certainly like to do all we can to help. But, of course,
I certainly don't expect a contract and a check today. A few days would be fine.
Alice chuckled. That's asking a lot of the machinery around here. Generally, it takes a few weeks to produce a contract, and another few weeks to grind out a check, minimum.
I understand. Of course, I wouldn't expect special treatment just walking in here after 30 years.
Well, we'd like to do anything we can. We'll certainly look into reprinting some of your books, Mr. Smithton. I'm afraid I can't promise you anything at the moment, but...
You're very kind. What titles do you think would go these days?
She teethed her lower lip. Well,
Fortress Planet, perhaps?
A classic, and one of my favorites, she lied whitely.
You flatter me. Blood Beast of the Demon Moon?
Is that a horror number?
On the cusp. How about my fantasy, Castle Ramthonodox? Then, of course, there's my story collection, Bright Comets and Other Obfuscations.
Your work has been somewhat neglected.
I'm a has-been, you mean. Forgotten.
Hardly, she said.
Oh, it's true. And I never was prolific.
Unfortunately, quantity does count as well as quality.
But it seems to me that I never did receive the last few royalty statements that were due.
Alice sat up.
Oh, I realize that 30 years is a long time, and your records...
Well, as a matter of fact, we do have a number of open files. Authors whose estates or heirs we can't locate. It may very well be...
She got up.
Won't you please wait here while I check with our accounting and legal departments?
He cashed the check at a local bank and walked down Madison Avenue, heading for a little curio shop he used to know in the Lower East Side. It had been tough persuading Alice Sussman and the people in accounting to cut him a royalty check this very day. The domination spell he had cast over the entire office had barely worked. Back home, everyone in the Bishop Publishing Galaxy would have been his willing slave. They all would have leaped out a 10-story window for him, single file. Here, forget it. The spell had only oiled the machinery a little bit. But it had worked. Done the job. Well, there'd been a little give and take. Allie, at lunch she told him to call her that, had just about insisted that he submit an outline and sample chapters of a new book. Instead, over Chicken Lo Mein, he spun out the plot of a sequel to Fortress Planet, quite off the top of his head, and she loved it. Well, the spell helped there a little, he had to admit. He hadn't written a word of fiction in years, and it must have been dreadful bilge he spilled out. Anyway, she'd offered a $14,000 advance, and he couldn't bring himself to refuse. Besides, he was stranded here and needed the money. All in all, New York hadn't changed as much as he'd expected. Numerous landmarks had disappeared, replaced by austere modern structures. He rather disliked the ubiquitous Bauhaus influence, but plenty of familiar sights were still left. He remembered this part of town well. He began to notice that there were more distressed people milling about than he recalled seeing during the Great Depression. He passed a slovenly middle-aged woman who carried two great bags stuffed with debris. She was followed by an emaciated man in a filthy overcoat
who seemed to have difficulty controlling his tongue. These and other unfortunates made up a good percentage of the sidewalk population. Wetting a mental finger and putting it up into the psychic wind, he got a subtle but overriding sense of decay, of desuetude, of things coming apart. Pity. It was a good town, but it had once been a great town. The curio shop was just where he remembered it. The shops around it had been long since boarded up. A derelict lay unconscious on the sidewalk a few doors away. In the other direction, a nervous-looking youth regarded him from the doorway of an abandoned storefront. He entered to the soft tinkling of a bell. The place was stuffed to the ceiling with an amazing collection of miscellaneous junk, and he was astonished to recognize some pieces from years before. Obviously, business had not been brisk. The place smelled of must, dust, and stale cigar smoke. There was a young, sallow man behind the counter. He did not smile when he asked, "Can I help you?"
"Is Mr. Trent in?"
"Why, yes, he is. Who shall I say is calling?"
"Connie. John Connie."
"One moment." The young man slipped through a tattered curtain into a back room. There was a murmuring of voices. Then the young man returned.
"Mr. Trent will see you. This way."
He followed the young man into the back room. There, seated at an ancient roll-top desk, was a man in his early 60s wearing a gray suit of fashionable cut, along with a burgundy tie, a tailored shirt with a crisply starched collar, and oxblood loafers burnished to a mirror shine. Even in the dim light, he cut an imposing figure. His hair was blonde-white, his face thin. His eyes were ethereal blue discs over a thin blade of a nose. The mouth was small and precise. He regarded his visitor, eyes narrowing, straining for recognition. At length, and with some astonishment, he said,
"It is you."
"Hello, Trent."
Trent rose and offered his hand, nodding to the young man who retreated through the curtain.
"Incarnadine," Trent said.
"Greetings, my long-lost brother,"
Incarnadine said in Haplin, the ancient tongue of the even more ancient tribe of the Haplodites. "How dost thee fare?"
"Thou art a sight for longing eyes," Trent answered.
"Let's stick to English," he added, "or Alvin will start to wonder."
"Alvin looks okay. I'll bet he's heard many a strange thing back here."
"You're right. Have a seat."
Trent dragged up a battered hardback chair. Incarnadine sat.
"It's been a long time."
"How did you ever manage to get here?"
Trent said.
"Well, I've been meaning to crack the problem of the lost gateway for the longest time. Just recently, it occurred to me that it could be one of the orbiting variety, the kind that don't necessarily stay inside the castle. So, I whipped up a flyer, searched the sky over the castle, and sure enough, there it was. Had a devil of a time chasing it down, though."
Trent lit a small brown cigar and puffed it.
"After 30 years, you decide to do this. Why?"
Incarnadine shrugged. "Any number of reasons. I miss New York. I miss this world. Lots of memories here."
He smiled. "I thought you might have been stranded here when the spell stabilizing the gateway went on the fritz."
Trent looked hard at him.
"You thought, and it takes you 30 years to decide to find out for sure?
What is time to a spawn of Castle Perilous? Sorry, were you stranded? Are you?"
"You said yourself that you found the thing floating in the sky. Where did it leave out?"
"About 3,000 feet over the East River."
Trent whistled.
"And you were flying a magical contrivance?"
He shook his head.
"Tough spot to be in."
"Yeah, I'd really forgotten how hard it was to practice the recondite arts around here."
"What did you do?"
"Well, when the plane dissolved, I tried just about everything on the way down.
At about 3 seconds to impact, I tried a simple protection spell, and that saved the day, and my hide. I hit pretty hard, though. Fortunately, it was only a few strokes of swimming to shore. I didn't get a drop on me.
You were lucky. Still, I wonder why you risked it.
We've been getting a lot of guests from here in the past few years. Some of them would like a way back. I'm here to see if I can establish a permanent gateway again. Trent's pale brow rose.
You did it for the guests? Those losers?
It's the least I could do. I would have seen to it long ago, but one, I've been busy. Two, most of the guests like the castle and want to stay, but some don't, and I thought we owed them.
How about all the rest?
Some have stabilized gateways. The others, well, someday I mean to do something for them too.
Most of those damn holes should have been plugged long ago, Trent said, scowling. The place is nothing but a big, drafty funhouse.
Do you realize how much power it would take to keep all the aspects sealed up? Keeping the particularly nasty ones shut up uses enough already. Trent chewed his cigar.
Well, I'm no expert on castle magic.
He took the cigar out and tapped the ash into a ceramic tray.
So, you say it never occurred to you to find out what happened to me.
I'm embarrassed to say that although I certainly wondered, I always thought you could take care of yourself in any situation.
I see.
Trent's smile formed a small crescent.
Actually, it was years before I discovered the gateway had skedaddled. I like it here, as you knew. One of the reasons I never really worried about you. Well, you were never really solicitous of my welfare.
Nor you of mine, Trent.
Trent grunted. Let's be frank. We were rivals for the throne. Dad favored you, and that's all there was to it.
Trent tapped out the cigar.
Look, we have lots to talk about. Let's drive to my place. We'll have dinner, hash over old times. What do you say?
Sounds friendly.
It is, Inky. Wait a minute.
Trent got up, parted the curtain, and called out,
I'm leaving early. I'll drive. Get a cab home.
Yes, Mr. Trent. Trent unhooked a camel's hair overcoat from an antique coat tree and pulled it on.
Let's go.
The car was a blue Mercedes sedan, meticulously polished and parked next to a sign that read, Absolutely no parking.
Hell of a nice car to leave on the street, Incarnadine remarked.
I have a few friends on the police force who look after it for me.
Nice to have friends.
They got in and Trent started it up and headed east.
I'm surprised you still have the old shop. Still need a front?
Nah, not really. You were very lucky to find me there. My employees open the place up maybe 2-3 days a week. Most of my business is strictly legitimate these days. Real estate, stocks, the usual. The shop's still a good write-off, though.
He chuckled.
I've been depreciating the same inventory for decades.
Still deal in art?
My old hobby. I own a gallery on the west side.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.